Good morning. Good to see you this morning, and welcome to Gospel Alliance Church. We're excited that you're here and a part of what we believe God has in store for us each this morning as we position ourselves to hear and receive from God. So we're glad you're here and expecting, as God shows up, that our lives will be changed and we'll be drawn in greater affection for Him. And so before we kick off, I just want to share just a few things to be aware of. First of all, if you're a visitor here this morning or if you've come a couple weeks and haven't filled out a Connect card, we have positioned the Connect cards back on near the kiosk back here. And if you would take the time to fill that out and just set it there, we would be grateful for you to do that. And there's information about who we are at Gospel Alliance Church that you can grab and read and understand a little bit more about who we are. Also, tonight is our Vision Dinner annual meeting. And so tonight at 6 o'clock is when the dinner kicks off, followed by Bob sharing kind of highlights and the staff about highlights over the past year, and then Bob sharing his heart for the 1-3-5 year, what it might look like in the future. And so you don't have to be a member to be a part of that. You can come out even if you're not a member and hear what's going on. But that begins tonight at 6 o'clock, and you can certainly be a part of that. Also, if you're new to the Gospel Alliance Church or you're interested in becoming a member, we have starting next week, a start here, or starting the 27th, a Start Here class that you can be part of. You can check your bulletin out for more information regarding that as well. And next week, we're going to...
Where do we get a bulletin from, Pastor Allen?
Where do you get a what?
A bulletin. Where do we get a bulletin from?
When you come in, I guess.
Right there in the kiosk. Okay.
At the kiosk. Okay, so if you didn't get a bulletin, you can grab it there. Thank you, Bob. Also, just so you're aware, for our bag brigade, the item of the month this month is mac and cheese. And so if you want to bless the bag brigade in that way, you can simply drop mac and cheese off in the blue container in the back. Also, coffee's available in the Commons Ground Cafe, and our offering will be over here and in the back drop-off this week. Next week is when we'll start passing a bag, or actually we'll be bringing the bag to you, and you can drop it in. But just know that that change is going to happen starting next Sunday as well. You know, in honor of who God is, would you stand as we open in prayer and seek the Lord, and then we'll sing together. Dear God, we thank you and praise you for, God, just who you are, and that we are brought into relationship with you, and that now in this moment you've invited us, God, to sing and give you worth through the words that we sing. And God, we don't want to just come and hear a good sermon, and we don't want to just come and hear good music. God, we want you to continue to cultivate our hearts and draw us to yourself, God, so that we can grow in deep relationship with you and be used, God, to draw others around us to find the Lord and Savior that we ourselves, many of us, have found. And so, God, may you have your way here today. And now, God, may you receive the worthy worship that is due you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Allen. This morning we're going to sing a song together, a song entitled Grace on Top of Grace. And that seems like an interesting concept, but we pull it from John chapter 1. And in John chapter 1 we read, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And out of his fullness, we have all received grace in place of grace already given." And so with Christ's coming, when he stepped down to become God in flesh, he brought with him the grace of God. And in his life and resurrection and in our choice to follow him, we receive that grace. But we daily receive the grace of God as well in his forgiveness and his blessings and just so many things. So this morning, I know it's 8 a.m., I know it's a little early, but we're going to praise the Lord for the grace that we receive. We're going to lift his name high and just declare truths about who he is. Let's sing together.
Now, heaven came down.
worship together this morning. We're going to declare some more truths about who God is this morning.
Of the Son of Man, stories of the Savior, holiness with human hands, treasure for eternity. No ear had heard, no eye had seen.
My strength in the battle.
Father, we praise you this morning. Lord, you are worthy. We thank you for the work that you do in our lives every day. Lord, we thank you for the truths that are being declared this morning. Father, we pray that as we learn more about who you are, as you reveal yourself to us, Lord, that we also might see more about who we are in you. Continue with us, we pray. But you hear me when I speak. You don't keep my heart from breaking. When it does, you weep with me. You're so close that I can feel you when I've lost the words.
I know that I am loved.
believe. Oh, I believe what you say.
Saying the truth about who you are, Lord, and we know that your scripture speaks truth, and so what you declare over us is true, and I pray that you would help our unbelief this morning, prepare our hearts for your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. As you have been, if you've been around for the last few weeks, you know that we have been talking a lot about these new things that we started earlier this year called Discipleship Families. So I have up here with me this morning, Jim, why don't you come over here? Jim Bowman is here. He was a part of one of our first Discipleship Families here at Gospel Alliance earlier this year before the pandemic. So Jim, I wanted you to come up here and share a little bit what you've experienced over the last 6 months or so with your group.
Absolutely. Before I do, though, I'd really like to say that if you ever feel called to serve in this church, please answer that call, because it's a very fulfilling thing to do, and it opens you up to what it really takes to run the things in this church. And as I stand up here at 8 a.m. On stage to talk to you right now, I'm kind of humbled for what our worship team does. The energy that they bring to us to get our hearts right to worship every single week, I just want to say thank you so much. Because it is not easy to get up here. Except for Jordan. I think that bum deserves everything he got coming. I only bust on the people I love. But anyhow, so the one thing I want you to think about is the expectations that we had when we came here. We had no idea what to expect when we were invited to join the family. And when we all first grouped together at the Kelly's house, we all kind of looked around at each other and thinking, wow, there's a lot of different people from different walks of life, and we don't all really know each other. There's some older, some younger, some parents, some not parents. There are some that were very introverted. There were those that were notoriously outspoken. I'm not looking at Chrissy Usher. If I'm not here next week, call the police. But we love you too. Again, I pick on people I love, right? So the relationships, I think it's, we can all agree that following Christ is not something we can do alone, right? It's something that you need other people to be a part of. It's about relationships as much as anything else. And when you're part of a discipleship family, what we've come to realize is that when you put God at the center of building relationships and building a family, that it can be so much more than any relationship you've ever had before. So our expectations have changed. When we first looked at each other and saw these group of strangers, this is now a group of strangers that my wife and I, we can't imagine our life without. I mean, they're our family like nobody else has really ever been. My wife and I don't have a lot of family in this area. And so when we came to this church, we had a lot of things get fulfilled, and of course, God's going to meet those needs. But when we had our discipleship family put together, and as we started to grow and have relationships, that cup really just overfilled. And so the ministry that we do is we do things with Bag Brigade and a couple other things we have in the hopper. It really makes you a part of something with the church in an intimate way that we've never experienced, and we really hope everyone here gets to experience it as well. So I only had 2 minutes to talk, and there's no way I could give you what our experience has been in 2 minutes. I could probably stand up here for the whole sermon and tell you about it, but if you're asked...
I won't be able to talk.
Well, that might be all right now and then.
Okay.
But anyhow, please come in with an open mind. Please sign up for one. You're not going to be disappointed. We were asked to meet every week, and we thought that was going to be a crazy thing to do. And now we can't imagine meeting any less than that. In fact, a lot of times we don't. We're often hanging out multiple times a week doing different things. Or if Lee needs help at the door, and he sends out an email at 7 a.m., hey, can one or two people help at the door? He's got a whole army of people that are ready to help. Or if Kathy needs help with the Bag Brigade, we're fighting over helping out with her. So you really have a family. It gives you a more intimate connection with the church and with each other. And it's something that I wouldn't give up for the world.
Thank you, Jim.
You're welcome.
I appreciate it. Well, if you do want to be a part of a discipleship family, you just need to contact my wife. Her email is in the bulletin, on the website, variety of other places you can find out. We're going to be starting 2 new groups coming up by the end of the year, so you can easily be a part of one of them. And Jim said, you won't be disappointed. Well, you might be, because it's always people, and sometimes people don't get along with each other. We'll talk more about discipleship families tonight at our annual meeting, Vision Dinner, so we'll share more with you about that and how you can be a part of that, because we're supposed to be a family, but we can't be a family of 500, so we have these little families that we call discipleship families. So everyone, we want to see everyone have the opportunity to be involved in one of those. You know, for me, for Julie and I coming over here from New Jersey last year, basically a year ago this month, we didn't have any family out here either. And we didn't have any friends. And so it's all been a journey for us in finding new friends and developing new family and learning new things and adjusting to our house and adjusting to the neighborhood and adjusting to the driving up and down and up and down. Because New Jersey is a pool table. So, you know, it's even new rhythms of life in how you're going to start your day and what you're going to do. So one of the rhythms that we have now is we start with coffee on our deck, and it gets to overlook the Mon Valley and the river and everything. And Julie always makes the coffee. I think I might have mentioned it to you last week. Well, this past week, I decided I was going to surprise her. Now, I didn't make the coffee, but I actually poured her coffee for her. Big time thing. The only problem was, it was a dirty mug. And she looked at me, and as I did it, she goes, you know, that was from last night. And I was like, pouring good coffee into a dirty mug, not a good thing. Now, when my parents, change the subject completely here, when my parents died years ago, would it have been a good idea for me to have taken their coffin, because it looks nice, put it on the screen, see the nice little wooden coffin, ornate, well-crafted. Would it have been good for me appropriate for me to take that coffin and put it in my living room. What do you think? It's a nice piece of furniture, isn't it? Would you put it in your living room? Why not? Because it has a decomposing body inside, right? You don't want that in your living room. When it, what is inside is just, if not more, important that's on the outside. You can look at a tree in your backyard. You can look at a tree in the forest, and it might look strong. It might look stout as it stands tall. But on the inside, it could have heart rot. And soon that tree, this fungal disease, is going to rot that tree from the inside, and it will crack and fall over. And you'll wonder, what happened, until you see what's on the inside. What's on the inside is just as important, if not more important, than what's on the outside. And it's the same for our lives. We need to take care of our inside as much as we need to take care of our outside, because no one wants a cup of coffee in a dirty mug. No one wants a decomposing body in a coffin in their living room. No one wants heart rot to destroy their lives. So that's why we've begun this series called How to Care for Your Soul. And last week we saw exactly what this last song was about and what God says about us, that we have to work on our core, that there is an identity that lays a foundation for our lives. And today I want to talk about how it's important to cleanse out the toxins in our body, to get rid of the things that are gunk us up and tie us up. When I first started in ministry, there was a veteran pastor who told me, as I was starting out there, he said, look, Bob, you will know who is real after 7 years. See, people can pretend for about 7 years before they show their true colors, or they just leave your church to go to another one before you ever find out what their true colors are. Now, I don't know if that's true everywhere, but I observed people hop from church to church about every 5 to 7 years. And I did notice that after 7 years, the garbage in people's lives floated to the surface. Many Christians have mastered the art of looking good. We look good. But a quote I heard from a speaker once was, we won't get well until we are more concerned about being good than we are with looking good. We won't get well until we're more concerned about being good than we are about looking good. So my encouragement this morning, my challenge this morning in how we can, the exercise for our souls to work on that inside part of us, is recognize that your soul needs regular cleansing. It needs a regular cleansing. It has to be a part of our daily life. See, Jesus started out his ministry with a simple message. Repent, because the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Now, usually when we think of repentance, we think of, repent! You're going to hell! The end is near! And we see this picture of groveling and humiliation and begging people, or maybe we see this picture of going to a confessional. And we have this picture that repentance is this stereotypical yelling and crying, this massive event. But now look, last week we saw how important it was to embrace God-given identity, that we're secure, that we're safe with God, that he's a safe person, that when we come to him with our issues, when we come to him with our brokenness, when we come to him with our sin, it isn't an issue of rejection, it's an issue of forgiveness. One author said that the self that God persistently loves is not my prettied up pretend self, but my actual self, the real me. But master of delusion that I am, I have trouble penetrating my web of self-deceptions and knowing this real me. I continually confuse it with some ideal self that I wish I were. Our souls need regular cleansing. We need to get rid of this gunk that's in our lives, this garbage, the toxins that are in our bloodstreams. We need to get rid of those things, and we do that through repentance. Now, I don't know about you, but oftentimes we think of repentance as something different than what the Bible really pictures it as. You know, it's that guy on the street corner, and it's all a matter of changing your behavior. Well, the word repent in the New Testament means to change your mind, to alter your thinking, to realign yourself. It's like sometimes your car gets out of alignment. You've had that. You know, you're driving and the wheel's always pulling to one side. And, you know, you hit a curb or a pothole and suddenly the entire system of the car is out of whack. Or for me, I have this issue with my pelvis that if I twist the wrong way or do something, sure enough, my pelvis goes out of whack and I have to go to the chiropractor. He does a spinal alignment and he aligns all the my bones in my back so that they're all the way they should be, and it will then calm down all the pain I have and the twisting and the nerve numbness I get, because the whole system is out of whack because one little part has been twisted. Repentance is realigning how we think. It's realigning our lives, the way we think, the way we consider God. It's bringing ourselves in alignment with Him. Our souls need daily cleansing. And we do that in two ways. And the first way we do it is by changing our mind. About what? About what are we changing our minds about? Well, the first thing I think we change our minds about is about your God. We change our mind about our God. And I say it like that because Paul, when he was talking to this early Christian group in Thessalonica, he told them, he gave this picture of what repentance is when he said, for people are talking about you, and this is what they're saying, how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. There's that picture of realigning away from the false gods to the true God. That's what repentance is. It's turning away from false gods to the true God. Remember that the root of all of our sinfulness is unbelief. We believe something or someone else will meet our needs and provide for us more than the real God. We believe that God's not enough, that we need something else. So we have these other idols, these other gods in our lives that we look to, that we lean upon, that we want those experiences or those things or those people that deep down we believe that they will make us feel better. They're the mini gods, the little gods. And they will provide for us, or they will even establish our self-worth. For example, adultery may be rooted in the belief that another person can provide acceptance that I'm not getting from my spouse or from God. Stealing may be rooted in my desire that money will provide security for me. It'll be my safety net. If I'm addicted to food and constantly, it might be because I believe it's temporarily going to make me feel better because my life stinks right now. If I'm in the habit of manipulating people or intimidating people, maybe it's because I don't trust that God, the real God, will change people, so I have to get them to do what I want them to do. It's no wonder that the very first commandment, to love and worship the one true God, shapes all the others. So where is unbelief showing its head in your life? What are the idols in your heart? Who do you go to, or what do you go to instead of God? Who do you get acceptance from? Where do you derive your sense of importance in life? Where do you feel safe? What do you really get angry about? See, our souls need to be cleansed from all the false gods that we tend to go to. So we need to change our thinking about what's the real God. That He's more worthy, that He's better. He's better at providing for us than fill in the blank, whatever it might be. But it's not just changing our minds about who God is, which one's the right God, but it's also about our lives. We need to change our mind about how we're living. One of the early churches was filled with broken people, like most churches are. Some just don't talk about it. But it was filled with all these messed up people that were not the models of virtue. They weren't looking good. They were messed up and they were imperfect. So Paul thought it necessary to point out to them a distinction between real repentance and kind of like repentance that looks good. And so in one of the letters he wrote, for godly sorrow produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly sorrow produces death. For see what determination this godly sorrow has produced in you, but also what eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what fear, what longing, what zeal, what punishment. And so he points out that there's two kinds of sorrow. You know, when you do something wrong, you feel bad. There's two kinds of that feeling. One is a worldly sorrow, he says. That doesn't lead to genuine repentance. That doesn't lead to generally changing your mind. It just is that I'm sorry. You know, I feel sorry that I got caught. I feel bad that the consequences are really negative. You know, I got to deal with these consequences. I just feel bad about that. Or, you know, I really feel that you think poorly of me now because I let you down and I did all this. Or if I'm sorry because I failed. It's just all worldly sorrow. It really doesn't bring us to real change, real realignment. But godly sorrow is when I'm really sorry for my sin. I'm deeply sorry for hurting you, God. How I've thought of it is in my own relationship with my spouse and my wife, and over the years, and you know, when you're married for 35 years, there's lots of opportunities to say, I'm sorry. And there's lots of opportunities where you say, I'm sorry, and you really don't mean it. Well, you really mean it, but you're not really, it's just like, let's just get over this and get on to the next thing. You know, I'm sorry. Or there's that times when you're really apologizing because you recognize the pain you caused by your words or your actions. See, that's the difference. It's saying I'm sorry, and it's recognizing the pain that we cause. It's recognizing what's broken. We had a pastor years ago in one of the churches I was in, our youth pastor, and he fell into a moral failure, and he was with the elders and everything. We were putting him into a restoration process, things that he could do to reestablish himself and help him grow. And after the meeting, a couple of the elders came up to me and said, Bob, he's not really sorry. He's not broken yet because he got caught. And sure enough, 4 months later, he's back doing what he was doing. It's just, it wasn't real for him. It was worldly sorrow. So Paul points out that there's a genuine repentance that leads to determination. He says here, to be changed. And I will do whatever is needed then to realign my life. Do you really want to change? See, our souls need that regular cleansing from all that gunk in our lives. We need to change our minds. But not only do we need to change our minds, there's another part to this cleansing that takes place, is this idea of coming clean. Coming clean. The Apostle John now, he's writing about what it is to be a real believer and a follower of Jesus. And he says in 1 John chapter 1, he says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to be cleansed from all unrighteousness. You go to the typical church, you wouldn't expect John to say this, if we say we have no sin, because we always say we have no sin. Let's just look good. But remember, if we really want to be well, if we really want our souls to be healed, if we really want to care for our souls, we have to acknowledge that we're really broken, that there's something wrong with me. And so we need to come clean with ourselves. We need to come clean with ourselves. See, we can deceive ourselves and be blinded. That's why I say, if you say you have no sin, what does he say? We deceive ourselves. I don't have a problem. I can stop anytime I want. I've already dealt with that. It's really not that bad. Yeah, the Bible really doesn't mean that. I haven't done anything too serious. Oh, you can't judge me because you got problems of your own. If you say you don't have a problem, you're deceiving yourself. If you deny that your heart is bent toward doing things that turn you away from God, that there are other gods in your life, then you're just fooling yourself. If you minimize your sin, John says, then you're imprisoned by it. So whether it is simply complaining all the time, having a critical spirit, being cynical, pride, gossip, spreading rumors, cheating, selfishness, greed, worry, hurtful words, we need to just call it what it is. Sin. A couple authors aptly pointed out that people are afraid to look at themselves honestly, to see marks of moral decline, to pry beneath the layers and expose greed, fear, and pride. Many of us have found a comfort zone and we want no one meddling with it. I think there are many singing in church choirs and serving on church boards. They are blinded to the light of biblical truth. No matter how sensitively presented, Many years' practice at tuning out threats of confrontation has made the process of denial almost automatic. He is able to sit through sermons without feeling more than a twinge of conviction. He is complacent, and his complacency is strengthened with every selective disregard for truth. If you say you have no sin, you're lying to yourself. Now, I know that sometimes we're reluctant to admit our faults because, you know, maybe we're in a relationship where we've been victimized in a relationship, whether there's abuse or infidelity or criminal acts. But even in those situations, you are the only one responsible for yourself. So even if you're only 1% guilty compared to the other person's 99%, we need to take 100% ownership of that 1%. Because owning that 1% is not going to invalidate the 99 things the other person did. No. But what it does is it cleanses your own soul. And that's the whole point. It's about our souls and what God wants to do in our souls. And our souls need regular cleansing. It needs regular coming clean. And coming clean with ourselves and admitting that I'm not really as good as I pretend to be. But obviously it's not just coming clean with ourselves. We need to come clean with God. Because in verse 9, he points out, if we confess our sins, he, talking about the Lord, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So there is a point of confession with God, which is a detailed admission of our sin to God. It's agreeing with God that what we're doing is wrong. It's judging ourselves. It's being honest and fessing up and saying, all right, my motives, my thoughts, what's going on inside of me. It's not generic and superficial. You know, like you end your day saying, Lord, I sinned today, and you know it, and there are a lot of things I did, but I really don't have time. Good night. Amen. No, it's not that. It's not, oh, Father, if we have done anything wrong, please forgive us. No. It's not if and we. It's yes and me. It's when I plumb the depths of my own heart and acknowledge my own brokenness to God. Basically, it's being transparent and honest with the Lord. The way that John writes, if we confess our sins, he's writing it as though it's a general pattern in a believer's life, that this is something you naturally do. This is something that's a part of your life. This is a transparency with the Father. And remember, you can be transparent with the Father because of our identity. We're safe and secure. So it's all right if we're broken, because he's already accepted us. He's already made us safe. He's already made us significant. So we're not in the business of trying to prove ourselves to him. So there's a sense that I can be honest with him. I can live transparent with him. Reality is, you know it anyway. But it's good for our souls to cleanse ourselves. So it's not like John saying if we confess one sin that he'll forgive one sin. If we confess two sins, he'll forgive two sins. And if we forget something, That's not what he's saying here. He's saying it's a pattern that those who are close to the Father recognize their brokenness. And they open up and they're honest with their brokenness. And so God forgives those who agree that they are sinners. This past week, just in a small way, we were driving home from one of my softball games, and Julie happened to come watch the game, and I did really well, which I don't do on our church team. So we're driving home, and I said to her, I said, playing on this team is really stroking my ego. And she goes, uh-oh. And I said, no, this is good, because I need to keep on admitting that so that I know that my identity is not based on my performance on the ball field. I need to remind myself that this is a delusion. This isn't real. And it's that lifestyle of transparency, it's the lifestyle of honesty, that what John's talking about here, he even uses the figure of light. If you're walking in the light, honesty, transparency. It's normal and natural. But it may not be just coming clean with ourselves, and it may not be just coming clean with God. There might come a place where we need to come clean with others. Because we need each other to help us experience Jesus' forgiveness. You know, it's not that we have to confess our sins to others, but there's a time when we're caught in this cycle, this loop of beating ourselves up for things that we've done in the past, that we need someone else to remind us how much that Jesus loves us and how much he's forgiven us. There's times when we keep secrets, fearing that other people are going to think bad of us. And all that does is it bounds us up with anxiety because we're worried they might find out. And our souls then are gripped. They're not free. They're not healthy. Or we hide behind smiles in religious activities. How you doing today? Fine. Everything worked well? Yeah, you just beat your kids up in the car. But, you know, hey. And what all we do is we feel empty week after week. We ignore the hard questions about our lives because we prefer to argue about theology, politics, and what other people are doing rather than what we're doing. And we make up lies to cover lies, to cover lies, and then we live in a state of worriness and stress, and we really never get close to people because we have all these walls up. It's those times that we need to come clean with others, and we need each other to experience God's forgiveness and his healing, because that's where it takes place, at that deeper level within us. Years ago, we had in another church I was at, we had a man that we were inviting to be an elder in our church. And he asked to have a secret meeting or a private meeting with the elders, and he was telling us he started to confess all these things in his past, that he was a drug dealer, that he hurt people with ice picks, that he was scamming money, and all these other things, all these horrible things. And it was all before Jesus was in his life. But he needed to do that to get it all out. And to realize, and we were like, you know, that was before Christ. It's all covered at the cross. Or the numerous couples, and I think of two in particular, who were believers and ended up having sex before marriage, but kept it hidden and no one knew about it. They didn't even talk about it. One couple in particular never even talked about what happened. And as they met with me, it was the first time they had admitted it to anybody else. And I asked, did you ever confess your sins to one another on what you did to one another? Well, no, and they're wondering why their relationship was filled with shame and why they felt they were bound up with him. And just coming clean with each other experienced the freedom and the healing of God. Well, a friend of mine who robbed a church stereo system when he was a teenager. And then he came to know Jesus a few years later, and he goes back to that church, meets with the pastor, confessed that he had sold it, he didn't have it anymore, but confessed what he had done when he was a kid. And it was, well, the pastor was like, you know, nothing we can do about it now and forgive you. And everything. But it wasn't about that. It was about this. It was about the freedom in his soul. It was about cleansing his soul. Or an older believer who confessed to me the pride of being good and thinking that I deserve good things to happen to me because I'm so good. Or the woman who finally confessed that she was addicted to shopping. And it wasn't until she admitted it that she was free. Or this deacon and his wife in the Baptist church I was a part of years ago that confessed that they were really just relying upon being religious and going to church and just really arrogant, proud, resentful, and judgmental, they finally said. And just coming to that point to admit that. And each of these people that I mentioned experienced the newfound freedom in their souls as they experienced the forgiveness of Jesus with each other. They didn't put on a show. They weren't looking good. They wanted to be good. And they were real. Our souls, they're tender. They're clogged up. They need regular cleansing. And so we need to realign our minds, decide who the real God is, and come clean about it all. David, King David, a man after God's own heart, who we know fell in so many ways, big ways. He wrote, "When I refused to confess my sin, I was weak and miserable, and I groaned all day long. Day and night, your hand of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Finally, I confessed all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide them. And I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord." Gospel Alliance Church, we won't get well until we are more concerned about being good than we are about looking good. Our souls, they need a regular cleansing. So before I pray, here's my suggestion for you this week. Here's what I suggest you do. And even maybe even during our last song here. I would suggest that you take some time to write down a confession, to go through your life and think back over the things you may never have confessed. And write them out to God, or just pray them back to God, but write out a confession. Or you can actually take the time this morning as we're going to open up the prayer room Julie will be up front here guiding you back into the prayer room. You can come and you can pray with others. Maybe you need someone else to say, stop, you already confessed that once. You don't need to go through that 10 million times. Maybe you need someone to just pray over you and to remind you of the forgiveness we have. Or maybe you just need time alone as we sing to come up and kneel on up front here by yourself with the Lord. Or maybe it's not for today. Maybe you need time to process. It's all right. Maybe you need time to make a plan, to think through the questions of who do I go to instead of God? What am I afraid of losing so deeply? What makes you feel good about yourself? What really gets you upset? Or what are you protecting yourself from? And it's only as you go through these things, I really believe as we go through this, and I'm going to do this too this week, we will experience a freshness on the inside. We may not look good to each other, but we'll be good. And what do you think matters more? Coffins in our living room? Dirty mugs on our countertops? Rotten trees in our backyard that are still standing? Let's pray. Father, you say that if we live transparently before you and come to you, if we confess that you forgive, that you're here, that you are that Father that we've read about who runs forward to welcome us home, that's the kind of God you are. And so for each of us this morning, would your Holy Spirit right now do that work, kind of like the magnifying glass, the flashlight on our phones, to shine inside of our souls? Would you show us where there's gunk that needs to be admitted? As things that are holding us back. The things that we do to look good rather than be good. Holy Spirit, would you do that this morning? It's only something you can do, Lord. Thank you that you are safe. That there's no rejection. That there's only forgiveness, freedom, and healing. In Jesus' name.
We're going to sing a song called Spirit Lead Me. I mean, the worship team will begin, and I just encourage you to sit, to listen, and to just respond in your chair, or if you feel led to head to the prayer room or pray up front. Whatever the Spirit leads, I encourage you to respond, but just listen for His voice.
This is my worship, this is my offering, in every moment I withhold nothing, I'm learning to trust you, even when I can't see it, even in suffering, I have to believe it. If you say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. And when you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. I don't want to follow my own way. I'm done chasing feelings. Like a burden, but I could grasp it. You took me further, further than I was asking, simply to see you. It's worth it all. My life is an altar.
Spirit, lead me.
repentance and confession often begins on our knees or with our heads down. But the Father doesn't leave it there. He puts his hand underneath our chin and he lifts our head and he looks us in the eyes. And he says, I know. I know you. I forgive you. You are still mine and ever will be. Would you stand with me? Lord, collectively as a people, we are broken. We are religious. We look to our goodness so much. We rely upon symbols. And we dress up. So we confess our sin of looking good, of smiling when we're hurting, of saying everything is fine. No, it's not. Of hiding. And we admit that we need you, the real God. Religion, no more vices, even our hobbies, Lord, we've overdone them. We've looked for safety and security and other things. We admit them to you and confess to you that we need you alone. Some of us here are angry with other people. We release that anger, Lord. We confess our anger. Receive you, your forgiveness and your freshness over our souls. So revive us. Where you say to release, we will let go. So now, to him who is able to present you blameless, perfect before his throne, to him who is able to complete the work he started, the work that I can't do, you can't do. To him who is worthy, to him who says that you are loved, that you are safe, that you belong, to him that is good and kind, to him that calls us and invites us to a deeper place with wonders, with insight, mystery that we have yet to explore. To him who gives us a hope beyond this world, beyond our life and our death. To him be all the glory. To him be all our praise. To him be our lives. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. We thank you, Lord.